Hello, my name is Shashank Sinha, and I am an Advanced Heart Failure and Cardiac Transplantation Fellow here at the University of Michigan. I'm also a Research Fellow at the Institute for Healthcare Policy and Innovation. Today, we'll be discussing our work examining the changing face of critical care cardiology. This work will be published in Circulation Cardiovascular Quality and Outcomes. Let's first begin our discussion with this classic portrait. Do you see what I see? Do you see a woman? Is she young or old? What does she look like? Now hold that thought. We'll return to this in a few minutes. I'd like to spend the next few minutes taking you on a journey. I wish to share with you the origins of cardiac critical care, how things have changed over the past several decades based on work by my colleagues, and then take a deep dive through our own retrospective study on how the underlying patient population in the modern cardiac intensive care unit has changed over time, and finish with thoughts on where our young discipline is headed and its implications for training and staffing. This timeline illustrates landmark events in the evolution of the coronary care unit. In 1923, the first case series of 19 patients with acute MI was published. In 1961, the first concept of a coronary care unit was presented to the British Thoracic Society. In 1967, Drs. Killip and Kimball reported on the experience with 250 patients in the cardiac intensive care unit. They demonstrated that mortality rate had decreased from an astonishing 26% to 7%. It is important to remember that CCUs were originally designed as coronary care units to improve the rapid detection and defibrillation of life-threatening ventricular arrhythmias, which are dangerous heart rhythms from the bottom chambers of the heart, following heart attacks. Due to advances in technology, medical care, training, and organization, as well as shifts in the underlying patient population, the CCU has transformed from a focus on rapid resuscitation into a modern CICU focused on comprehensive critical care of all patients. In fact, modern CICUs treat a wide array of acute cardiovascular diseases, which include cardiogenic shock, heart failure, and complex arrhythmias. Dr. Jason Katz and colleagues at Duke University published a landmark study in critical care medicine in 2010, highlighting the 17-year experience of nearly 30,000 patients at their institution from 1989 to 2006. This figure shows that there was an overall rise in primary non-cardiac diagnoses such as sepsis, acute kidney injury, and acute lung injury and infection. Largely based on this seminal work from the Duke experience, the American Heart Association issued a scientific statement on the future of critical care cardiology in 2012, pointing to the potential need for cardiologists to expand training in managing critically ill patients with chronic cardiovascular conditions. 3 years later, in 2015, the American College of Cardiology followed suit by publishing the Core Cardiovascular Training Statement, or COCATS 4, that outlined additional requirements for trainees interested in critical care cardiology. We recognize that the composition of CICU patients and their needs may be changing due to an aging population, declines in heart disease, and a shift in risk factors for cardiovascular disease. Yet comprehensive data on the number, types, and outcomes of patients admitted to CICUs across the United States is lacking. We thus sought to address this gap. Specifically, we performed a retrospective study using large administrative claims data to answer two specific questions. One, how have the number and types of hospitalized patients with CICU stays in the United States changed between 2003 and 2013? Two, what are the in-hospital outcomes of this patient population? We hypothesized that temporal trends in CICUs would demonstrate a rise in patients with primary non-cardiac diagnoses and non-cardiac procedure use, as well as in risk-adjusted in-hospital mortality. We used 100% Medicare Provider Analysis and Review, or MedPAR, claims files from 2003 to 2013. Our final study population included 3.4 million acute care hospitalizations for fee-for-service Medicare beneficiaries. Note that MedPAR data captures all billable diagnoses, procedures, demographics, and in-hospital outcomes from hospitalized patients admitted with a CICU stay. All patients with fee-for-service eligibility at the time of admission were included. For this study, we defined hospitalization with a CICU stay using revenue center codes within the claims records. Finally, to ensure a consistent cohort of hospitals with CICUs, we included only those 806 hospitals billing more than 20 hospitalizations with a CICU stay during every year throughout the study period, that is, from 2003 to 2013 consecutively. We excluded patients with hospitalizations in intermediate care units only. To avoid counting hospitalizations for patients without cardiovascular disease temporarily boarding in the CICU, we excluded any patients who did not have a primary or secondary cardiac diagnosis at discharge, which only represented 5.1% of total patients. This approach to excluding boarders was evaluated in a sensitivity analysis that showed consistent results. We used the clinical classification software developed by the Agency for Healthcare Research and Quality, or ARC, to aggregate ICD-9 diagnoses codes into 281 unique diagnoses based on multi-level categories. We also extracted data on hospital and CICU length of stay, as well as discharge status. We grouped elderly patients admitted to CICUs into two categories based on their principal diagnosis at discharge, namely primary cardiac diagnoses, as represented here, as well as primary non-cardiac diagnoses, as represented on the right. In addition, we used ICD-9 procedure codes to identify non-cardiac procedures including invasive mechanical ventilation, non-invasive mechanical ventilation, central venous catheterization, blood transfusion, and hemodialysis. For cardiac procedures, we used the following ICD-9 codes, as shown on the right. We calculated the percent of total hospitalizations with a CICU stay in each disease category for each year. The denominator represented the total number of hospitalizations each year in fee-for-service Medicare beneficiaries. We now present results using stacked bar graphs, with the total height of each bar representing 100% of admissions for any given year. In addition, both unadjusted and risk-adjusted in-hospital mortality were reported. Risk-adjusted in-hospital mortality rates were calculated using a logistic regression model that adjusted for patient factors such as age, gender, and race, as well as the total number of Ehlers-Hauser comorbidities. Interestingly, our studies show that the rate of CICU admissions per 1,000 fee-for-service Medicare beneficiary hospitalizations during the study cohort period decreased from 93.7 in 2003 to 74.3 in 2013. Demographic characteristics, including sex and race, remained relatively stable over the study period. The mean age increased minimally, while the proportion of patients aged 85 years or older grew significantly. From 2003 to 2013, the percentage of CICU patients with comorbidities increased. The number of patients with three or more comorbidities grew from 32.9% in 2003 to 54.6% in 2013. For cardiovascular comorbidities, the number of patients with CHF increased 2.6-fold, pulmonary vascular disease 5.9-fold, and valvular heart disease 2.0-fold. However, the number of patients with hypertension, diabetes mellitus, and anemia remained relatively stable over this time period. Several changes in non-cardiac and cardiac procedures were observed during the study period. For instance, mechanical ventilation and non-invasive ventilation rates, central venous catheter use, hemodialysis rates, and transfusion use all increased during the study period. With respect to cardiac procedures, pulmonary artery catheterization decreased, along with diagnostic cardiac catheterization and percutaneous coronary intervention. If a picture is worth a thousand words, this figure tells the whole story. A corresponding decline in primary cardiac diagnoses was observed, largely due to a substantial decrease in primary diagnoses of coronary artery disease from 32.3% to 19%. A more modest decrease in primary diagnoses of congestive heart failure was noted from 9.8% to 7.5%. During the same interval, the rise in primary non-cardiac diagnoses, shown in shades of blue here, was not attributable to a single condition, but the largest increases resulted from primary diagnoses of infectious diseases, which nearly doubled from 7.8% to 15.1%, and non-infectious respiratory diseases, which increased from 6% to 7.6%. When individual discharge diagnoses were considered as opposed to group categories, we find similar patterns and a remarkable transformation of the cardiac care unit. From 2003 to 2006, sepsis, which represents an inflammatory response to a life-threatening infection, climbed from number 11 to number 6 in the rankings, and then to number 5 in 2009, and finally to number 2 in 2013. Note that acute myocardial infarction, or heart attack, in the meantime, declined from 16% to 12% during the study period, but still remained the most common discharge diagnosis in 2013. For more information, interactive slope graphs and heat maps are available at the following links for your review. Interestingly, risk-adjusted mortality declined modestly for patients admitted with primary non-cardiac diagnoses from 13% in 2003, represented in blue, to 11.2% in 2013, while risk-adjusted mortality was lower for patients admitted with primary cardiac diagnoses, shown in red, and remained relatively stable between 6.9% in 2003 and 6.6% in 2013. For the overall cohort, risk-adjusted mortality declined slightly from 9.3% to 8.9%. Our study should be interpreted within the context of multiple limitations. First, our study relies on Medicare claims data, which has well-known inherent limitations for measuring confounders, and thus cannot specifically address the mechanisms driving the underlying shifts, including changes in coding practices. To minimize this potential coding bias, we performed additional sensitivity analyses not shown here that were consistent with our overall results. Finally, our analysis was restricted to elderly patients hospitalized in the CICU, and our findings need to be confirmed in additional studies involving a broader payer mix and age distribution. In summary, hospitalizations with a CICU stay are increasing for primary non-cardiac diagnoses. Comorbidities have significantly increased, and CICU stays with primary non-cardiac diagnoses are associated with higher rates of non-cardiac procedure use and higher risk-adjusted in-hospital mortality. Overall, risk-adjusted in-hospital mortality did not worsen over time, and so the CICU may be increasingly becoming a setting where patients with cardiovascular disease are treated for a variety of acute, high-risk illnesses, although overall care does not appear to be compromised. I'd like to conclude by sharing the vision for the future, particularly with respect to training and staffing implications. Our work should help inform the development of appropriate training and staffing models. Two options have been proposed. Option one, co-management of the CICU with a general ICU intensivist, or option two, that cardiologists must broaden their critical care training. So as we look to the future, several questions must be answered. Who belongs in the CICU? And how should we provide care to these vulnerable high-risk patients? Several key similarities and differences now exist between today's general ICU and cardiac ICU patients. And as our young field slowly matures its evidence base into a full-fledged specialty, I invite your engagement and your collaboration and welcome your candid feedback. So let's look again now. What do you see? Do you see what I see? Do you see the face of a young woman or of an old woman? I'll tell you what I see. I see the changing face of critical care cardiology. I would like to thank my co-authors for the gift of their collaboration, guidance, and mentorship without which this work would not be possible. In particular, I am grateful to Drs. Michael Schody, Hallie Prescott, Jack Awashna, and Colin Cook in the Division of Pulmonary and Critical Care Medicine, and Drs. Devraj Sukul and Hitinder Gurm in the Division of Cardiovascular Medicine. Finally, I would like to extend my deepest gratitude to my primary research mentor, Dr. Brahmaji Nalamothu, who served as the senior author for this work. I would also like to express my gratitude to my clinical mentors above, Dr. David Bach, Dr. Peter Hagen, and Dr. Kim Eagle, respectively, as well as my external mentors below, Dr. Jason Katz, Dr. Sean Van Diepen, and Dr. David Morrow, who have been instrumental in my professional development throughout fellowship training. Thank you very much for your time.